Zerufino, from Turin, and he is correct, Turin, Torino.
Yeah, sorry, yeah,
Yeah,
story.
okay. So he's going to talk about quantum steps for SFTs. So welcome,
Yes,
Peter.
okay. Okay, thank you. Hi, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity. Today I'm going to tell you about this work written with Carlo Maccaferri, Riccardo Poletti, and Beniamino Valsesia, in which we outlined a systematic procedure for adding stub into a generic quantum string field theory. This talk is organized as follows. I will begin by briefly reviewing some basic aspects in the construction of the open-closed string field theory action and the definition of stub deformation. And then I will describe our systematic procedure for adding stubs into a generic quantum string field theory. And we will see this method at works in the simple example of a cubic quantum theory. After that, I will discuss the equivalence of on-shell amplitudes for theories with and without stubs by focusing on the explicit example of the open one-loop tadpole. And finally, I will conclude by giving some possible future direction of our research. Okay, so let us begin by briefly reviewing some geometrical aspects in the construction of the open-closed string field theory action. And in general, we can define the open-closed string field theory action as a sum in genus, number of boundary, k closed insertion, p1 open insertion on the first boundary, p2 open insertion on the second boundary, and so on and so forth, of fundamental vertices weighted by the string coupling constant kappa according to the topological expansion, where we call the phi the closed string field, that is a generic element of the closed Hilbert space, that is associated with a given bulk CFT. And of course, we can decompose the closed string field in terms of basis vectors, Ci, and the coefficients, Phi, which are understood as target space BV fields and antifields. And the same for the open sector. The fundamental vertices are defined as an integral on an appropriate D form, where D is the dimensionality of moduli space, over the so-called fundamental domain. And the idea under the construction of these fundamental vertices is that when we compute amplitude by following the usual quantum field theory techniques, we can recover the off-shell amplitude defined as this integral of the D form over a section. And this section is a section in the space of the so-called decorated Riemann surfaces, in which each point corresponds to a Riemann surface and a possible choice of local coordinates around each punctures. And of course, along this section, there are some surface degenerations, and the idea is to decompose this section and then define the fundamental domain as the subregion without these surface degenerations. And of course, the missing region of moduli space will be recovered through the Feynman diagram contribution, which corresponds to lower dimensional fundamental vertices connected through propagator. As you can see explicitly in the example of one open string on the annulus, that is an example that we will see again at the end of this talk. And this amplitude is associated with a one-dimensional moduli space that can be parameterized through the circumference of the annulus, T. And then it's clear that we have two surface degenerations. The open string degeneration for T that goes to infinity, and this corresponds to the collision of the two boundaries, and the closed string degeneration for T that goes to zero, which corresponds to a very high and narrow cylinder. And therefore, the amplitude will be given by the sum of three contributions, the fundamental vertex and the Feynman diagram contribution in the open and closed channel. Of course, by imposing that the amplitude can be written as the sum of these two kinds of contribution, corresponds to impose some consistency conditions on the construction of fundamental vertices. And this consistency condition corresponds to impose the geometrical BV master equation, where B is defined as the sum of all possible fundamental domains weighted by the string coupling constant according to the topological expansion. And then this equation corresponds to a set of consistency condition order by order in the string coupling constant. In particular, this is the boundary operator, and the bracket are the geometrical BV bracket, which has the meaning of glues to different Riemann surfaces through a strip in the open scenario and or through a tube for the closed case. Delta is the geometrical BV Laplacian, and it can be written as the sum of the open contribution and the closed contribution, where the closed BV Laplacian glues a Riemann surface to itself through a tube, whereas the open BV Laplacian glues a Riemann surface to itself through a strip. Notice that there are two topologically inequivalent ways of gluing a Riemann surface to itself through a strip. Indeed, if we attach the two strip endpoints on the same boundary, we are increasing the total amount of boundaries by one, and we are leaving the genus unchanged. Whereas if we attach the two strip endpoints on two different boundaries, then we are increasing by one the genus and decreasing by one the number of boundaries, as you can see in this case for the annulus. Furthermore, it is useful to rewrite the open-closed string field theory action in terms of simple form and multi-string products, which have an implicit integration over the fundamental domains. In particular, we define the L multi-string product as maps which gives as output a closed string field and which takes as input K closed string field, P1 open string field on the first boundary, P2 on the second boundary, and so on. And in particular, this wedge product means the symmetrized tensor product of K closed string field. The tensor prime separates the closed sector and the open sector, and the wedge prime in green is the symmetrized tensor product of boundaries. And the odot product in purple is the cyclic tensor product of open string field on the same boundary. And of course, among these L product, there is the closed BST charge. The M product gives as output an open string field and takes as input K closed string field, P1 open string field on the first boundary, and PB open string field on the special boundary. Where for special boundary, I mean the boundary on which we are inserting the resulting open string field that this map gives as output. And we consider the tensor product of open string field on the special boundary because the symmetry under cyclic permutation of open string field on the special boundary is recovered through the requirement that this M product is a cyclic with respect to the open symplectic form. Of course, there is nothing of special about the choice of a special boundary, and this translates it into equivalence relation between M product with different special boundary choices inside the symplectic form. Moreover, these two products are not independent, and we can see this property by considering a term in the action associated with a Riemann surface with at least one open insertion and one closed insertion. And we can write this contribution in two ways, either by using the L product and the closed symplectic form, or by using the M product and the open symplectic form. And therefore, we have a duality property between the L product and the M product. As we described in this paper with Carlo and Jakub, we can rewrite the open-closed string field theory action in terms of the symplectic form and the multi-string product in this way. And, and if we consider fundamental domains with at least one insertion, the geometrical BV master equation is implied that the action must be a solution of the BV quantum master equation. which in the usual BV approach means that the action is quantum, is consistent at quantum level, namely that the generating functional does not depend on the gauge fixing. And by imposing the BV master equation, this implies some condition on the multistring products, which assume the meaning of homotopy relation. And such a homotopy relation can be rewritten in a compact form as an idempotent structure, where N is the open closed multistring product, and U is defined as the sum of these two objects, where thick U open and thick U closed are higher order co-derivation associated with the so-called Poisson bivectors, which are operators defined through the basis vectors and the dual through the symplectic form basis vector, which inverts the symplectic form in this sense. I will describe in more detail the meaning of this thick N and thick U later in this talk, but at the moment the punchline is that we can impose the consistency condition in these three equivalent ways. Okay, so let us now come back to the definition of the off-shell amplitude that, as said, it is given by an integral, this deform, over a section. But of course, there are infinitely many possible choices of local coordinates, and then infinitely many possible sections, which gives different fundamental vertices and then different action, which are related through field redefinition, and then they share the same almost minimal model, namely the same on-shell amplitudes. And adding stub to a theory is a particular deformation of this theory induced by a dilatation of local coordinates. And to better appreciate the geometrical meaning of adding stub, let us discuss about the gluing procedure of Riemann surfaces, namely the plumbing fixture procedure, that we can see at work in this simple example in which we are considering two discs, and we would like to join these two discs through a strip. Then we consider two local coordinates map, F1 and F2, and we impose this condition on the local coordinates, where Q is the so-called Schwinger parameter that goes from 0 to 1, and it can be rewritten as e to the minus s, where s parameterized the length of the strip, and it goes from 0 to infinity, and clearly for s that goes to infinity, we have the surface degeneration. And the corresponding term in the Feynman diagram contribution to the amplitude is the Siegel propagator, obtained by integrating the plumbing fixture parameter between 0 and infinity. If we consider a dilatation in the local coordinates parameterized by the stub parameter lambda, greater than 0, of course, we have this plumbing fixture condition with a new plumbing fixture parameter that now goes from 2 lambda to infinity. And therefore, the associated propagator is given by the integral between 2 lambda and infinity. Then it's clear that by adding stub to a theory, we are decreasing the region of moduli space covered through the Feynman diagrams, and we are increasing the region of moduli space covered through the fundamental vertices. And this is why, from the point of view of multistring products, for example, in the Witten theory, we cannot just replace the two products, M2, with this new definition, in which we inserted the so-called stub operator, which implements the dilatation in the local coordinates. Because by doing so, we are neglecting some region of moduli space, and we need an infinite number of new multistring products and tilde of n, thus getting a non-polynomial open string field theory action. And as discussed in this paper by Schnabel and Stettinger, this product can be constructed explicitly by using homotopy transfer techniques. Furthermore, in this work by Herbin and Fira, it is discussed that the stub non-polynomial open string field theory action can be recasted in a cubic theory by introducing an auxiliary field in this form. And moreover, they pointed out two interesting homotopy transfers. The first one is corresponds to integrate out classically the auxiliary the field, then ending up on the starting non-polynomial stub theory, where for integrating out classically, I mean solve the corresponding equation of motion and then replace the solution in the action. And the second homotopy transfer consists of transferring the theory on the line given by this equation. And this gives the Witten theory. And actually, this second homotopy transfer is our starting point for our procedure. Indeed, transfer the theory on the line means integrate out those degrees of freedom which don't satisfy the line equation. And it is equivalent to perform a field redefinition and then integrate out the orthogonal degrees of freedom, as we will see in a minute. So let us then discuss our procedure. We discuss first the classical case, and then we will generalize it to the quantum scenario. And this is our setup. We are considering an action that is a solution of the classical BV master equation, where rho is the is our degree zero string field, Q is the nilpotent operator which define the kinetic term, and omega is the symplectic form. And to introduce the stubs, we define the stub operator that we call C lambda equal to e to the minus lambda L, where lambda is the stub parameter that goes from zero to infinity, and L is a Gradman and BP is even operator such that it commutes with the operator Q. And of course, what we have in mind is the Virasoro zero mod L naught and the BRT charge. And therefore, we assume the existence of a Grassmann-Hod operator B, such that the commutator between Q and B, the graded commutator between Q and B, gives L. And moreover, we assume that the cohomology of the BRC charge Q is contained in the kernel of L. And we define a projector P, which projects onto the kernel of L. So now we can describe our procedure that can be summarized in two steps. In the first step, we introduce a decoupled auxiliary field chi in P bar of H, where P bar is the complementary projector of P, where P projects onto the kernel of L. And notice that by doing so, we are not introducing any propagating string field. And therefore, we can integrate out chi, and integrate out chi at classical level correspond to set it equal to zero, because it is a decoupled auxiliary field. Now we perform this field redefinition implemented by an orthogonal matrix constructed through the stub operator C lambda, and thus getting this stub rotated action. And we can notice that this field redefinition leaves the kinetic term unchanged, and it is trivially related to the fact that it is an orthogonal field redefinition, and the interacting part of the action depends on this peculiar combination of string field. Moreover, we can notice that the new string field sigma that is given by this combination of the starting field rho and the auxiliary field chi belongs to P bar H. And the reason is that chi belongs to P bar H by assumption, and the operator 1 minus C lambda square gives a non-vanishing result when it acts on element in P bar of H. And therefore, this sigma is an auxiliary string field that can be integrated out, and this gives the stub theory. Notice that this procedure is just a useful rewriting of Erwin and Fira method. And indeed, if we specialize our procedure to Witten theory, we get this action. And by performing this trivial field redefinition, we get exactly the Erwin-Pirat action. And of course, if we integrate out the stub-rotated auxiliary field sigma, we get the non-polynomial open string field theory. And if we transfer the theory on the line, we get the Witten theory. And it is particularly clear in this formalism, because transfer the theory on the line, as said, is equivalent to integrate out those degrees of freedom which don't satisfy this line equation. And if we came back to the starting variable chi and rho, we can notice that chi chi is equal to zero on the line, and then transfer the theory on this equation means to integrate out chi in the starting theory, thus getting the Witten theory. Okay, now we want to generalize our procedure in the quantum scenario. Then we consider an action that satisfies the quantum BV master equation. And the main difference in this case is that when we want to integrate out, the main difference is that in this case, integrating out the auxiliary field or the stub-rotated auxiliary field really means to perform the path integral, the BV path integral. And for example, when we consider the extended action, when we consider the extended action, integrating out the auxiliary field chi, it is not equivalent to set it equal to zero. And to see so explicitly, we can compute the BV path integral. And in order to do so, we can introduce the Seeger propagator, which satisfies the Hodge-Kodaira decomposition. That means that we can decompose the projected space P bar H as the direct sum of these two subspaces. And we call the BI the basis vector of the subspace of Q exact states, and the CI the basis vector of this subspace. And therefore, we can decompose the auxiliary field in this form. Moreover, we can notice that the kinetic term for the auxiliary field can be rewritten in this way. And we can notice that by assumption, this matrix Qij is a non-degenerate. Okay, so we want to perform the gauge fixed BV path integral, and the obvious gauge fixing is H chi equal to zero, or equivalently beta I equal to zero. And therefore, the BV path integral reduces to a super Gaussian integral where Qij, as said, is non-degenerate. And therefore, it can be computed, and this gives as a result the starting action and a constant term that is related to the one-loop vacuum diagram. Therefore, we define the extended action S prime of rho and chi as the starting action plus the kinetic term for the auxiliary field minus this constant term, in order to end up on the starting theory when we integrate out the auxiliary field chi. Okay, and then we can apply the field redefinition, thus getting this stub-rotated action. And notice that by doing so, we don't get any contribution from the measure of the integration, because we are considering an orthogonal field redefinition. And then, therefore, the stub theory is given by integrating out the stub-rotated auxiliary field in the BV path integral approach, and this gives a constant term that is associated with the vacuum bubbles and the dynamical part that we will describe in more detail later. And notice that the one-loop bubble that we get by integrating out the stub-rotated auxiliary field sigma is just the same as the one obtained by integrating the starting auxiliary field chi. And therefore, since we defined the extended action with this minus A, this constant term includes vacuum diagrams from two loops onward. Okay, to see this procedure at work, let us apply it to a simple example of a cubic theory. And so this is the action. We assume the A infinity relation on the multistring products, and we assume that the M2 product is cyclic with respect to the symplectic form. And these properties guarantee the fact that the action is a solution of the BV classical master equation. And when we apply the BV Laplacian, we get this contribution that actually this quantity is non-vanishing and ill-defined in Witten theory, because it is related to the closed degeneration. But however, we assume that we have a particular product M2 such that M2 of U is equal to zero. just to have a sort of a toy model on which apply our procedure. But of course, we can apply this mechanism even on a proper solution of the BV master equation, such as the quantum L infinity theory or the open-closed thin field theory action. So let us then introduce the auxiliary field chi as a totally decoupled string field, and we can, and it is useful to reorganize these two fields in a vector R that is an element of this Hilbert space H prime that is defined as the direct sum of the starting Hilbert space and the projected Hilbert space. We can then uplift the multi-string product and the symplectic form on H prime, and we can notice that they satisfy the A infinity relation and the cyclicity property, and then our action can be rewritten in this form. Let us now upgrade this formula to the algebraic level, following the prescription given in this work by Herbig, Macaferri, Schnabel, Vosmer. And in general, we can define the aqua-algebra as an algebraic structure given by the pair th prime delta th prime, where th prime is a tensor algebra, and delta th prime is a coassociative coproduct. And it maps the tensor algebra th prime in two copies of the tensor algebra tensorized through this new tensor product, tensor prime. And the usual definition of the coproduct is that when we act with delta on a bunch of states, then we insert the tensor prime in all possible way. We promote the multi-string product as co-derivation, namely as an operator which satisfies the so-called co-Leibniz rule with the coproduct, and in particular the definition of the multi-string product at the level of coalgebra are this relation. And we can define the total co-derivation n prime as the sum of the two co-derivation associated with the two multi-string product. And therefore, by using this formalism, we can rewrite the action in the so-called Wesu-Minowitten form by introducing an interpolating field defined such that R of 0 is equal to 0 and R of 1 is equal to R. And therefore, we can rewrite the action as an integral in the interpolation parameter T between 0 and 1, the symplectic form on H prime, capital omega, pi 1, which projects onto a single copy of Hilbert space in order to have only nested contribution, m prime, that is the total co-derivation, and sig the t, that is the one co-derivation associated with the derivative in the parameter t. And finally, this 1 over 1 minus rt is the so-called group-like element defined as here reported. Of course, we can, following the same reasoning, we can rewrite even the BV quantum master equation in the Wesu-Minowitten form, and by doing so, we make the nilpotent structure explicit, where this thick u prime is an higher order co-derivation associated with the Poisson-B vector, which inverts the symplectic form capital omega, and it is defined as the subsequent application of two zero co-derivation, where a zero co-derivation associated with a state, in this case, this zero co-derivation is associated with a basis vector, is defined as follows. When we apply this zero co-derivation to a bunch of state, we insert this vector in all possible way. Okay. And in this formalism, the field redefinition can be established between group-like elements by promoting the matrix O lambda as a homomorphism on th prime, where a homomorphism is an operator that satisfies this relation with the coproduct. And in particular, we define the homomorphism associated with this matrix O lambda in this way. Namely, when we act with this operator on a bunch of states, then we get a multi-string state characterized by the application of the matrix O lambda on each state. And therefore, the field redefinition can be written in this canonical form, and the stub-rotated action in Wesu-Minowitten form can be rewritten in this way by using the BPC properties of this common morphism of lambda, and where we define the capital M as this object. And if we write explicitly the capital one product and the capital M two product, then we get this operator, which means to act with the VRT charge on both components of the vectors. And this means that the filter definition leaves the kinetic term unchanged, and the two product is characterized by this composition, this the desired composition of string field. Okay, so now we want to integrate out the stub rotated auxiliary field in order to get the stub the action with stub, and then we introduce a canonical projector in this way. Namely, this is an operator which selects the first component of the vector and a canonical inclusion defined as here reported. And we can notice that this canonical projector and this canonical inclusion satisfy the retract property, namely pi iota equal to the identity in H, and iota pi is a projector, this trivial projector on H prime. We can then define the propagator in this way, namely it gives a zero in the first component and the Siegel propagator in the second component. And notice that here we are not considering the p-bar, the usual p-bar, because sigma is in p-bar of H by assumption. And this propagator satisfies the Hodge-Kodaira decomposition, and therefore we can decompose the Hilbert space H prime as the sum of three subspaces. And we named the basis vector in this way. And therefore, we can write this, the string field capital Psi as this composition, in which we can notice that the first term corresponds to a vector Psi 0, and the latter term are 0, sigma. And of course, we want to compute the gauge fixed path integral, and the gauge fixing can be obtained by requiring that beta I is equal to zero. Therefore, we get that the effective action can be written in this form, and we can then make the kinetic term explicit. This is the kinetic term for the auxiliary field, and this is the kinetic term for the field psi, and we can introduce a source term. And then by using common quantum field theory techniques, we can rewrite this line as a differential operator acting on a super Gaussian integral with a source term. And since this matrix is non-degenerate by assumption, we can define its inverse, hij, and then compute this integral. And the result gives a constant term that cancel precisely. These are constant terms that comes from the vacuum bubble in the chi integration, and we remain with this object. And by applying further quantum field theory manipulation, we can rewrite the effective action in this form as a logarithm of a differential operator acting on E to the action without the kinetic term for the auxiliary field, and then the condition gamma I equal to zero. And we can impose such condition by introducing a projector pi, which acts on the space of functional defined on the Hilbert space, H prime, such that pi alpha I is equal to alpha I, and pi beta gamma is equal to zero. And therefore, by defining this new operator pi tilde as capital pi and the differential operator which define the effective action, we can rewrite the effective action in this compact form. And now, by using some interesting results pointed out by Dobek, Yurko, and Pullman, we can rewrite this effective action as the sum of two contributions. The first one is the constant associated with the vacuum energy, and the second term is the dynamical part of the theory with stub, and the effective product are given through the following homotopy transfer, characterized by these three strong deformation retract, between th prime and th with the kinetic operator capital M1 and the BST charge. And then we can apply the perturbation given by capital M2 plus the Poisson bivector. And then the homological perturbation lemma tell us that we are establishing this interacting strong deformation retract. And the explicit expression for the transfer nilpotent structure is the following. So we can then split this expression in the sum of two contributions. The first one has the meaning of effective products, and the second one characterized the transfer Poisson bivector. And we can notice that we can make pi pass to the right of the Poisson bivector by replacing it by a new higher order co-derivation associated with this object, that is the Poisson bivector of the projected space, namely in which we are applying the canonical projector pi on the vector, the basis vectors and the dual basis vector. And thus we can rewrite this geometric series as the sum of two contributions, the first one, iota, and the remaining term. And by applying the strong deformation retract properties and the annihilation relation, we can state in total generality that the transferred Poisson bivector is given by the Poisson bivector of the projected space, that in our case corresponds to the starting Poisson bivector, the Poisson bivector which inverts the symplectic form little omega. Okay, now let us focus on the structure of effective product. They can be rewritten in. Sorry?
I have a question. So, this property that the tilde and the u being the same is like specific to strong deformation retract, because in deformation retract, I will expect that there is some basis shift.
Yes. No, I mean, when. Sorry, yes, let's come back. So this is the structure of U tilde, which the homological perturbation lemma tells us. But now when we consider this canonical projector, that is a homomorphism, which acts on the Poisson bivector of the space H prime, it is a homomorphism, then it acts on each state. And then we get this new operator that is associated with this object, in which we are projecting the basis vectors and the dual basis vector, and it is exactly the Poisson bivector of the projected space.
So you haven't did you use any side conditions? I think you use side conditions, right? This
any cyclic condition.
Did you use it when you were deriving it?
No, at this level, no. It's just this is the. Oh, sorry. Okay, no, at this level, we use just the fact that we can move, we can make this pi pass to the right of the Poisson bivector by obtaining this structure.
Okay, sounds, okay. So this is a generic result and holds in for every retract, is that what you're saying?
Yes. It's just about this, the structure of this Poisson bivector.
Thanks. I will think about it.
Okay. 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 Let's go ahead. We're talking about the explicit expression of these effective products. And we can write this expression in this form by making the capital M product explicit. And by factorizing this lambda to the minus one and the lambda to the left and to the right of this expression, and we can then constantly define a new canonical projector, which is this object, and a new canonical inclusion, which is lambda iota, which satisfies of course the retract properties. Namely, pi iota is equal to the identity in th, and iota pi. Sorry? Is there a question? No? Okay. Okay, and iota pi is our projector that can be represented through this matrix form. And following the same philosophy, we can define this new propagator, H lambda, that is this object here, which acts on a bunch of state following the prescription for the uplifting of a propagator on the tensor algebra. And this H lambda can be written as a matrix in this form. And as we will see explicitly in the next slide, when we compute explicitly this effective product, the propagator gives the only contribution that gives this propagator is the one associated with this object. That is exactly the propagator that, for example, Schnabel and Stettinger considered in their work. And therefore, we can state that our procedure is totally equivalent to apply an homotopy transfer, this peculiar homotopy transfer, described through this canonical projector, canonical inclusion, and this propagator, starting from the extended theory, namely the theory described through the string field rho and chi. And therefore, we can then write explicitly some effective product. In particular, now we are considering again the string coupling constant because we want the correct topological expansion. And then the classical product, the classical contribution are exactly the one pointed out by Schnabel and Stettinger. But now we have some quantum correction, such as this tadpole correction. And this correction is expected. Indeed, in this sort of quantum Witten-like theory, the one loop tadpole is fully constructed from a Feynman diagram. But after adding a stub, a part of moduli space near to the closed string degeneration is eliminated in the Feynman diagram expansion. And then we need this new fundamental vertex. Okay, so now using our method, we can prove explicitly the equivalence of on-shell amplitudes for theories with and without stubs. And the idea is to show that these two theories share the same almost minimal model. Namely, they give the same effective action for fields in the kernel of L. So the idea is, let's start considering the theory without stub, but described through the extended action, namely the action characterized by the string field rho and chi, and then we can apply the homological perturbation lemma to get the almost minimal model and the explicit expression for the corresponding effective products. And following the same reasoning, we can consider the stub theory and then apply the homological perturbation lemma to get the almost minimal model. But as just discussed, we know that the stub theory is obtained to an homotopy transfer starting from the extended theory characterized by the product n prime. Therefore, computing the almost minimal model for the stub theory is equivalent to perform two subsequent homotopy transfer. That is exactly the so-called horizontal composition as described in this work. And by applying the properties of horizontal composition, we can show explicitly that these two products are equivalent. Okay, so as I said before, we can apply this procedure even on a proper solution of the quantum BV master equation, such as the open-closed string-field reaction. And of course, we can prove the equivalence of amplitudes for the theory with and without a stub, even in this scenario. And now our task is to compute the open one-loop tuple in the open-closed string field theory framework with and without stubs. Of course, these two amplitudes, as said, are equivalent, but they are associated with different decomposition of moduli space. That is the point that you want to appreciate in this analysis. So, starting from the theory without stub, we can compute the on-shell amplitude associated with one open string on the annulus. And as described in the introduction, it is given by the sum of three contribution, the fundamental vertex, and the Feynman diagram contribution. associated with the open channel and the closed channel. And now we want to give an explicit expression to this product by using the SL2C vertices construction. So let us first consider the open string channel. We want to characterize this multi-string product, which takes as input two open string field and gives as output one open string field. And then when we consider the open symplectic form of an open string field and the product, this can be written as a correlator in the upper Alice plane with our three insertion and three local coordinates map, as it is summarized in this drawing, where these three local coordinates map are defined here. They depend on the two parameters, psi and lambda, which are not totally free because we must impose the non-overlap condition of local coordinate patches. And of course, this correlator can be written in the format of the surface state in this way by defining this particular surface state. And the contribution to the amplitude can be rewritten in this form, where phi is the open string insertion, OI and OI, the basis vector and the dual basis vector comes from the Poisson bivector, and that means to apply the non-separating open plumbing fixture procedure on the external open string insertion in this way. And therefore, we will integrate over the plumbing fixture parameter S with the Bigost insertion, of course. As far as the closed string channel, we want to define the closed tuple and this product, which takes a closed string as input and gives an open string as output. And we use the definition given by Carlo and Jakub in this paper. In particular, we define the closed string tuple as a boundary state with a tunable stub parameter attached, and with this projector, which projects into the level mesh states. And when we consider the closed symplectic form of this closed tuple and a closed string field, this gives a correlator on the disk of the closed insertion and then the local coordinates, as summarized in this picture. And in the same way, we can consider the open symplectic form with this product, and it corresponds to a correlator on the disk in which we can see the closed insertion, the open insertion, and the local coordinates map, where FO and FC are defined here, and this is the Kiley map, namely the function which maps the upper Alice plane into the disk. In order to have both definition on the disk disk geometry, in order to see explicitly the closed separating plumbing fixture. Indeed, when we compute the contribution to the amplitude, we have to glue these two disks, on the closing insertion, thus getting an integral over the closed plumbing fixture parameter. Finally, let us discuss about the fundamental vertex. It can be defined as an integral in the moduli space parameter T, because let us keep in mind that when we consider an annulus with one open string insertion, it is associated with a one-dimensional moduli space. And of course, the annulus can be mapped to a cylinder, to this cylinder, and we can parameterize the moduli space by considering the circumference of the cylinder. And this extreme of integration that I will discuss in a second are related to the plumbing fixture procedure. Then we will have a surface state, the so-called Beltrami form, and the open insertion, where this surface state is defined such that when we apply it on the open string field, then we get a correlator on this cylinder with this local coordinates map. So let us then discuss about this extreme of integration. In particular, when we consider the open plumbing fixture procedure, when we consider the open plumbing fixture procedure, we are considering this drawing, and then we are gluing on the two open string insertion, thus getting a one parameter family of Riemann surfaces topologically equivalent to the cylinder. And this parameter is the open Plumbing-Fissler parameter. And of course, we can map these surfaces onto the cylinder, and thus getting a relation between the moduli space parameter and the open Plumbing-Fissler parameter. And therefore, when we consider SO that goes to infinity, namely the open surface degeneration, then we get the open string degeneration, T, that goes to infinity. Whereas when we consider the Plumbing-Fissler parameter SO equal to zero, then we get a finite value of the modulus that is the lower value of moduli space that can be covered through the open string channel. And similarly, when we consider the closed Plumbing-Fissler, then we can read the relation between the moduli space parameter and the closed Plumbing-Fissler parameter. And when we consider the surface degeneration, namely when SC goes to infinity, then we get the closed string degeneration that in this parametrization arises for T equal to zero. And when we consider S equal to zero, we get a finite value of the modulus, T min, which represents the maximal value of the moduli space that can be covered through the closed Plumbing-Fissler. And finally, this local coordinate map F of T is fixed through the homotopy relation, because in general F of T can be any holomorphic function which continuously interpolates these two local coordinate maps, which are the local coordinate map that we get when we map the Plumbing-Fissler surfaces to the cylinder. Therefore, we can write explicitly the amplitude for the theory without stub in this form, and the amplitude for the theory with stub, in which we are considering independent, open, and closed stub. And therefore, as expected, these two amplitudes are equivalent, but they are associated with different decomposition of moduli space. And in particular, by adding stub, we are increasing the region of the fundamental domain, and we are decreasing the region of moduli space covered through the Feynman diagram expansion. Okay, so in conclusion, we clarify the quantum algebraic structure of the stub deformation in a generic string field theory. And so let us list some possible interesting future direction. The first one consists of better understand the vacuum energy. Indeed, it would be interesting to better understand how the vacuum bubbles that are generated by the path integral can be formulated by using some homotopy transfer techniques. Furthermore, it would be interesting to apply our procedure to the superstring field theory. And another interesting concept is the inverse stub operator. Indeed, although the stub deformation is a field definition, it is not invertible in a strict sense. And this can be easily seen from a geometrical perspective. Indeed, the inverse stub operator, in principle, removes some strip of worksheet. And then it is clear that it is not well defined in general. And another interesting point is to study the interpolating limit in the open closed string field theory. Indeed, we know that the open closed string field theory has a natural interpolating form, as described by Zwieback, for example, in which at the extreme of the interpolation, we have that the moduli space is mostly covered through open or closed propagator. And it would be interesting to understand how this interpolating limit is related to stub parameter. And so, thanks for your attention. Do you hear me? Sorry?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay,
yeah,
okay.
No problem. Okay, so we have plenty of time for questions. So if anyone has any question, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask.
Yes, I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yes, my question is in this rotating matrix O that you have defined at some point.
Yes.
You have a square root of an operator, and I wanted to ask how do you define this square root, or are there any assumptions on the stub operator that this square root can be defined properly?
Okay, yes. Yes, actually, in this filter definition, this 1 minus C lambda square in the square root can give rise to imaginary contamination when we consider, for example, tachyonic modes.
Yes.
And indeed, this stub rotated action can be seen in a certain sense as a the analytic continuation of the action given by Erving and Thirac, because we can obtain their theory by replacing sigma with this contribution, which of course removes the square root. But however, when you consider the on-shell amplitude, we get only real contribution, because because when we integrate out the degrees of freedom in p bar of h, then we are integrating out sigma and the contribution to psi that could be received imaginary contamination from this 1 minus lambda square. And furthermore, as we can see here, the in the structure of effective products, the operator 1 minus lambda just appear without the square root. In particular, this is the object that compare in that appear in the amplitude. And then we get a real on-shell amplitude.
Okay, okay, thanks.
Okay, nothing, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? And I can't see your raised hand. So if not, please let us thank Alberto for this very nice talk.
Thank you.